but all things are not profitable. All the things are lawful for me, but I won't be borrowing the power of any. That it's some things that, like, even drinking coffee, as simple as that. Paul was talking about, you know, I can have these things, but I ain't gonna be borrowing the power of anything but the Lord Jesus Christ. That I can do some things that's within the law. They're lawful. But I won't be bothered with power in it. That I can do them, but I don't obey them. And we're going to come out of Acts 12, 1 through 10. It talks about Herod, the king, that he squares forth his hands to vex the church, meaning harass it and to do evil to it. To certain members of the church. It was Peter, James, and John. And we know that they walked closely with Jesus, that back in Acts 5, that signs and wonders followed. People was being saved. They was healing people. And Chris will read that 1 through 10.
It was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to prosecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. When he saw that this pleased the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handing him over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for a public trial after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and sentries stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side and woke him up. "Quick, get up," he said, and the chains fell off Peter's wrists. Then the angel said to him, "Put on your clothes and sandals," and Peter did so. "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me," the angel told him. Peter followed him out of the prison, but he had no idea that what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. Ten?
Yeah.
They passed the first and the second guards and came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened for them by itself. They went through it. When they had walked the length of the one street, suddenly the angel left him.
Amen.
Yeah. One more verse, right? To 12?
Oh, that's it.
All right.
Like I was saying, that Herod stretched forth his hand. He put into action the plan to harass certain members of the church. Like I say, that when we're doing the work of God, that the enemy, that Herod was under the influence of the enemy to harass us or to bind us with so many things, for we can't do the work of God. But he went ahead and he killed James. And that brought me to when Jesus rose Lazarus from the dead. It said at the Passover that Lazarus was one that sat at the table with Jesus, meaning that he ate with Jesus, that he was a witness for Jesus. That it said that they came not to see Jesus, but to see Lazarus also. And the chief priests wanted to kill him. It's the same way that that Herod was a people pleaser. He even the Roman emperor wanted to put a statue in Jerusalem, but he stuck his neck out that he wanted to please the Jews so much, and he told him, "No, don't do it." So he wanted to please these people, and it's just like the enemy will use even people in the church to try to stop you and bind them, because he was trying to satisfy them. And it said that that when he had apprehended him, Peter, he put him in jail and delivered him to four quadrants means four squadrons or four men, means 16 soldiers to keep him, and 10 after Easter to bring forth. See, that's a sign of being religious, because, you know, like some people, they go to church and they say, well, I ain't gonna cuss you out today, but I get you Monday. You know what I'm saying? Because they know it was the Passover, that's why they didn't want to kill it. They didn't want to do nothing bad on that day. They was holding the religious ceremony. But after it was over, they was planning to kill it. But God had something different in mind.
Amen.
And it said, Peter therefore was kept in the prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. And Peter was bound, but sometimes the church, us as a church, when we see that a brother is bound in something, you know, meaning that he render powers to this thing, we'll begin to whisper and gossip about it instead of going to God and pray. It says that, get James 5:16. It says in Thessalonians 5:17 that we are to pray without ceasing.
James
before 5. We begin, there are 5:16. Say we are to pray without ceasing. Before we begin to, like he was saying, form an opinion on our brother, we supposed to come together. I'm talking out of the body, not single, and pray for him.
And we got to let God have the opinion, not us.
Amen.
Too often we have an opinion about something and it's really the wrong thing because we don't know all the facts.
Mm-hmm. Read it.
Yeah.
James 5:16. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth
much. Amen. That we are supposed to come to each other. We don't have to tell each other what we're doing. But it say, confess, say, brother, I'm struggling. I need y'all to pray for me. You know, if you want to tell them the sin that you bound by, you can. But it say, confess your faults. See, that's different than confessing your sins, because we confess our sins to God. And we can confess our faults to each other, that we pray for one another. That's so important to see that the church prayed for him without ceasing. Amen. In verse 6 says, and when Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains, and the keeper before the door kept the prison. That this is like that Peter, trouble was all the way around. He slept between the two soldiers. And he was bound by those troubles. And see, we have trouble on every side of us. You know, we have the guys over here doing this, guys over there doing that. But we don't have to, even though trouble is around him, even there were soldiers at the gate to keep him. You know, that the enemy brings so much against us to bound us, for we can't do the work of God. And when all these troubles around us, that we don't have to be bound by it. It said that the two chains mean that he was bound on each side, meaning that he was rendered powerless to this thing that had it bound. See, because being in prison is a restriction, but to be bound is mean powerless, that you obeying whatever you're bound by. Mm-hmm. See, you have two masters. One you're gonna love and one you're gonna hate. See, a lot of people think that I can be in between. Either you eat at the table of God, or you eat at the table of Satan.
There's no gray.
There's no gray. Mm-hmm. Either you're doing one or the other.
Come on, man.
It's true. And it's sort of ironic. Here we are in a place that everyone actually physically still is in prison, literally. You know, you're still inmates. And you know exactly what he's talking about more than some of these people, the physical part. Mm-hmm. You know, here you're locked up and you got bars, but you're really set.